gone through this slide. Am I correct? Can anybody tell me? This is, we have done this, right? I think we have done this, right? So we are going to the other area called loan facility. I think we have gone through bank overdraft, which you know this is only applicable to the people who have the current account, bank overdraft. And this is a very short term, and there is two way of permanent and temporary that you are aware, right? Temporary is of course clean basis, permanent of course backed by securities. So this is one of the best tool for a business people to have a current account where they enjoy this overdraft facility, right? And loan facility, in generally loan facility, we are going to look at all the loan facility that are available for different business segments, right? And these loans are a certain maturity period. You can call it as short term, medium term, and long term. So how these loan facilities could be calculated, looking at the maturity period. So when you take a loan, they generally, the borrower will ask what is the duration he will take to repay the entire loan. That is called repayment period. So the loan divided by the number of years that we say, suppose say you want to take housing loan, your age is about 35. Let's assume the retirement age is 55. So that you can go for, if your age is 35, you can go for 20 years loan, housing loan. So your repayment of that loan will be 20 years. So whatever the amount that you are taken will be divided by 20 years. That means if you want to calculate the monthly, then you each year 12 into 20 years, then 240 divided by the total amount. 240 months there. For when you say 20 years, you have to calculate monthly you are paying, right? So there you need to calculate 12 months per year. So 20 is 240. So 240 months, you have a time period to repay the loan. So whatever the quantum that you intend to borrow, divide by 240, and you get the monthly installment. Same way, if you take the loan quantum of 5 million, then the interest rate also will be added. So when it comes to loan facility, remember that there are two things. One is the repayment, your capital repayment. Other one is the interest cost. Because when the bank grant you the loan, they give you upfront 10 million to purchase house. Then they forego that 10 million to get 20 years that way to get that. So they need to recover interest from you. That is what the interest cost is. So the cost, there's a cost bank when they lend the money, there's a cost for the bank. What is the cost? Because these are depositors' money they're giving you. So there's a cost and there's a running cost and there is a administration cost, everything put together, and they have an interest rate. So what will happen when you, whatever the loan that you borrow from a bank, there are two components. One is capital repayment and interest. Put together, you need to monthly installment is interest plus capital. Both put together, you will call monthly installment. I need to pay so much. That so much what you pay is component of repayment of your capital plus interest, right? That is how the loan facilities are structured. The term loan. Term loan are generally taken for working capital, right? Working capital. Then what do you mean by working capital? In any business, you need to have a working capital. Working capital is generally you will have a current assets. That means for you to do business, if you look at any balance sheet of a business, you have current asset, you have current liability, which are factors which keep on changing based on the business activity. Say stocks. If you're having a business, you have a stocks. You have a cash balances, you have a debtors, you have a bank balances. All these are current assets, right? So similarly, you will have current liabilities. Say you have a creditors, you borrow goods on a credit basis. There are overdraft you need to repay. So those are creditors, overdraft. There are payment you need to pay, accrued payment. You have to pay whatever the utility bills. All that comes as a current liability. So what happened? You have current asset, current liability, 2-to-1 ratio. Your current asset should be double the current liability. If you have a current asset 200, current liability should be 100. That is a norm, 2-to-1. So the better, the best. if you have current asset more, you are strongly poised that you have sufficient working capital to run the business. So the working capital is where these funds are used to your day-to-day activities. That is called working capital. Acquiring a fixed asset is not a working, it's a capital nature. So the working capital is day-to-day activity where the funds are used to carry out your routine business, buying stocks, right? You borrow money to buy your stock. That is called working capital. So working capital funds is used to boost your day-to-day activities. When you are short of funds, you go for a term loan for 1 year or 2 year working capital, or you go for a permanent overdraft facility, which is also considered as a working capital loan, right? Then you go for a term loan, also granted acquisition of fixed asset. That means I told you land, building, machinery, these are fixed assets. Then again, you go for a term loan. Obviously, the term loan will be longer period because this value of loan and land and sorry, long, land and building and machinery, your furniture, fittings, all that's a bit expensive. So your repayment capacity may be 10 years or 15 years, depending on the value of the asset that you intend to purchase to look after the business activity. Maybe you want to put up a building to say you want running a restaurant, you want to modify, modernize your building, you purchase other land to put up. So those are in capital nature. So that is you call that again a term loan, but is in capital nature. So that is where the tenure for a period is 3 to 7 years. Yeah, sometime more than 5 years, we call it as a long term. Maybe up to 1 year, very short term. Then 1 year, 1 year to 5 years term loan, medium. Above five and above, sometime depending on the business, some loans may be 10 years above, maybe you may call it as a long term. The terminology used for a short and medium long term is there's no definition as such. It depending on the nature of the project, depending on the maturity period applicable to the project, this terminology varies. So generally short term in 1 year and 2 years are considered as very short term. Anything more than 1 year above up to 5 years can be tagged as medium. Anything more than 5 year and above, generally considered as long term. It's depending on the general. I'm just giving you the general norms, right? So to set up a new business also, you may go for a term loan. So maybe that is setting up a new business take a long time to. So that may be a long term loan. Financing a modernization, expansion of diversity. So you can go for term loan for various purposes. It could be business, working capital, modernizing or acquire a new asset or expansion of your business, right? And you may go for a medium or long-term investment for a project. So if you have a lot bigger project, say if Elis want to put up a new plant for a solar power, that is 25 years bigger project. So they might go for a loan of 20 years and above. So that's a bigger project, long-term project. So you can take loan from 1 year, maybe 20, 25 years, you can go. The term maybe varies, right? So that's what's called term loan. So that you need to remember whenever the terms loan are extended to the borrower, the lender, the bank generally work out the repayment capacity because there are why the longer tenure is given for the project and all because the project, when you give the loan, the project to start and to get cash flow generated take a longer time. Maybe first 2, 3 years, there's no repayment. So the loan is structured in such a way, maybe the repayment capacity starts from fourth year. That is how the project loan are structured. But when you are a salaried person, when you go for housing loan, immediately next month onwards, you need to start repaying. So that is depending on the nature of the loan and the borrower's nature, whether it's a salaried person or business person, sometimes working capital, if your current account, your ongoing business, then you can start immediately paying from next month onwards. But there are business, it takes time put it in order because they have certain business plan, but immediately they don't have a repayment capacity because the business has to generate income, then only they will have a cash inflow, then only they can repayment. Depending on the project, maybe the repayment period start after 3 years, maybe 4 years for a project loan, right? That is how it works. But you've got to remember there is a repayment, there is an interest component put together, it's an installment of a loan. So, right, that is how it works. Yes, so when you are giving a term loan, you take a security. I think we learned this mortgage, lien, pledge, and hypothecation. We have learned this, right? These are the secured legally, you take an agreement, because whenever the loans are given on a long term, so the bank is take the depositors' money or their own capital and lending to the, or they borrowed funds, they're lending you to the long term loans. So when the long term loans are given, in the event of borrower unable to repay, then the IRIS, so the bank should take security collateral. Bank always should take collateral, security, security, otherwise is collateral. What is security? Whenever you grant a loan, that loan should be supported by some security. Why do we take a security? In the event the borrower is unable to repay, or the business ceased, stopped, bankrupt, then how do you recover your money? There's no way to recover unless you have some asset taken. Then you try to sell that asset, recover your dues, and if there are any balances exist, you give it to the back to the borrower. So that is how, if you, even if you take housing loan, remember your house is mortgaged. The whatever the property that you buy is mortgaged to the bank. So that is what housing loans are given. So you must remember, even any loans, that the security, taking security is paramount, important, because that is depending on the borrower's repayment capacity. If the borrower doesn't have any meal, say you take a salaried person, you have a job, you take housing loan, you have been paying, after 5 years you lost the job due to some bad behavior or some fraud, inadvertently you got involved, your job is gone. So how do you repay? You have no income to repay. So bank might give a breathing space of 1 year, 2 years for you to, or maybe they restructure the loan and you have any repayment capacity to continue to pay the loan. If you don't have any option, then bank can't keep that loan for any longer. It's going to be a non-performing loan. So bank has to realize, because central bank also given certain guideline, banks can't keep the non-performing loan. But when I say non-performing loan, performing loan, two things. If you are keep on paying as agreed with the bank's repayment, installment and interest on a regular basis without any default, is performing loan. When you start don't paying, you are delaying, your income is not there, you are unable to repay, then you call non-performing loan. Non-performing means that loan is non-performing. That means the person who has taken the loan is not repaying to the bank. Those are not a good sign. Non-performing loan is not a good sign to the bank, because there is a probable loss to the bank. One fine day, there will be a situation where this borrower any longer has any income to repay the loan. In situations such, the bank need to recover. That is where the security is taken. It is applicable to individual loan to business loan. Every loans, bank required to take a security. That's what you ask the general public. When you talk to them, taking a loan from bank is very difficult. They say why? Because you must understand, banks takes depositors' money and lending. Therefore, that loan need to be repaid to the bank. Otherwise, the depositors cannot get their money back. Therefore, bank have lot of restriction when they grant loan to make sure the loan is somehow or other recovered. That is the reason bank takes security. Bank ask the people to sign a lot of documents. Why? They are lending to the depositors' money. Always remember that. Depositors' money is our lend. Therefore, bank has the responsibility to recover this loan proceeds and repay to the depositors. That is where all the stringent regulations are there, right? So in the case of a large project, there are project 10 to 20 years. Then the loan generally granted group. So yeah, sometimes consortium loans. So bigger projects are consortium loan, mean that bigger institution borrow loans, then there will be 2-3 banks put together to lend those bigger projects. I think we concurrent mortgage, we learn these are applicable to the bigger project, bigger size projects. Say one ABC company, a new company, they want 10 billion rupees loan, 10 billion. So no bank going to grant 10 billion to one company. So it's a huge amount, right? So then what happened? There are consortium. There are different lending bank, right? Concurrent. So that is also we will learn what happened. One bank cannot take. It's a both banks will finance for this project. That is also there in a term loan, right? Let us see. Syndicated. This is where the syndicated bank loan coming. This is where exactly I have explained. I think we learned this concurrent mortgage. Yeah. What is that concurrent mortgage? When a one mortgage is given to the different people of lenders. Why? That loan amount is large. That is you call syndicated bank loan. Syndicated bank loan mean, take example, if a Chinese company comes in Sri Lanka, they want to put up a huge project. So they are raising money locally. They are raising money. They are not bringing all the money. Whenever a foreign investment coming into Sri Lanka, you call FDI. What is FDI? Foreign direct investment. FDI stands for foreign direct investment. FDI, foreign direct investment coming into Sri Lanka, remember, they bring certain amount. Working capital, everything, they depending on the local banks to borrow. So if our local bank interest rates are very high, then the project may not take place. That is where the, always government try to keep the interest rate very low. The reason, whenever the foreign direct investment coming into Sri Lanka, like they want to invest in a huge, but let's say take example, a Chinese company coming, they want to take a railway into electrical side, electrical railway, they want to put a huge project, then they need a lot of money. So they bring certain amount, 20% of the project, they bring balance 80%, they want to borrow locally. So cases like that, when they approach a local bank, not a single bank willing to give, because the 80 billion, let's say it's a total amount of 10 billion they want. They brought 2 billion. Balance 8 billion they want to borrow from local bank. When they're approaching local bank, I don't think any of the local bank in a position to give 8 billion to one Chinese firm. They don't have much capital to give so much of loan to one bank. So those are large amount. Then what happened? A group of banks will willing to give a loan. Say Bank of Ceylon, People's, HNB, Commercial, Sampa. These five banks put together, they are going to give a loan. So it approaches by the first bank. First bank comes as a lead bank. You call it lead. There is their common. It is a lead bank. The first bank is they approach. So they are unable to lend. So they will say, okay, we will talk to other bank and see whether they are also willing to support this. Then what happened? The 8 billion is shared by four banks or five banks. So let's say HNB give, Bank of Ceylon give two, People's two, Commercial, Sampath, HNB give 1.5, some other, the 8 billion is looked into according to that. Then this 8 billion loan is given as a syndicated bank loan. Why? There are so many lenders there. Borrower is the one person, but the two different lenders. Then the borrower has only one asset to mortgage. So it is mortgage to different bank, that you know, concurrent mortgage. When a one asset to mortgage to different lenders, because there are different lenders come. Why? Because the loan amount cannot be given by one lender. It's large. Therefore, so many lenders coming in. But the borrower has only one property. The Chinese company has only one property. What is that project? Is the property. That is the asset. They will mortgage that asset to all the banks. That kind of a loan is called syndicated bank loan. Syndicated means large project where group of banks get together, grant a loan. At that time, the security is called project asset is taken as a security. That type of security is called concurrent mortgage. The mortgage is taken as a security, but there's a special name given, not a normal mortgage, it's a different type of mortgage. Why? One asset is mortgaged to four or five banks. That is what you call concurrent mortgage, right? So these are bigger projects, like say railway transport, as I tell, railway transport, yeah. Then large airport, seaport, you need colossal amount of money. So that is where the syndicated bank loans coming in, right? So you should understand what is syndicated bank loan. In your own word, what do you understand? When there is a huge project-related loan required by the borrower, where when you approach one bank cannot give that loan because the amount is large. In the event such, there are group of banks get together. They should, first of all, everybody go through the project and see it is viable. So you can't just because of Bank of Ceylon asking People's Bank, they don't give. They will go through project. Each and everyone has their own assessment of credit proposal. So each bank will go through the project and see whether that is they really require. So one bank might say, no, sorry, we are not interested in this project. They can pull out. So they say, sorry, we are not in a position to take part, then they will look for other bank. It is not mandatory just because of one lead bank has taken the project into positive, other banks, everybody has to agree to. No, if your policy, internal policy is not to grant a project of railway where the income generation is slow, it takes long time, you might not give a loans to that industry. Then you pull it out. But you look at long-term purposes because you when you are giving a long-term loan, you know you are going to get the interest for 25 years. When the project start kicking in, the project successfully done, you have a longer tenure of loan, right? So it depends your liquidity position. When I say liquidity, your cash position, whether you have enough money to, on a long-term basis, you can lend. If the project is viable, you might agree. So that is what called syndicated bank loan, right? Example, you can say railway project, highway, putting up a port, seaport or airport. Colossal amount of money is required, right? The Colombo City Port, what is they acquiring land from sea and building up? That's a real larger project where definitely four or five banks would have given a loan to Chinese company, right? What is revolving credit line? Revolving credit line is this is facility keep on revolving. That mean a limit is there for you. You take a limit. Say take example credit card. It's a classic example of revolving credit line. You have a limit of, you're taking a credit card. You have the, you spend that. Then what do you do? You repay. There again your limit will be there. There again you borrow. Then you repay. Then borrow. It's keep on you are utilizing this facility. The loan is there, loan facility is there, you use it, it is the amount is closed. Then you repay. Again, the amount is available for you. Again, you repay. That is called revolving credit line, where the credit facility extended for us with a certain limit of, say, for credit card, you have 50,000 limit. A permanent overdraft is a revolving credit line because you have a permanent overdraft debit of 5 million. Every time, any given time, you can draw a check up to 5 million. When you put money, the limit will be utilized for 3 million, limit comes to 2 million, but your permanent overdraft limit is 5 million. The available balance is fully utilized for 5 million, right? You have a 5 million overdraft facility. You have drawn the check up to 5 million. Your account is fully utilized. You don't have any check more, right? Because your limit is fully utilized. Then what happened? You have some cash coming in. Then it goes to credit your account. Then your limit is 4.8, 4.6, 4.4. But limit is 5 million. Your balance I'm referring now. Your current account balance is reducing now. 4.5, 4.8, 4.6, 4.2. It dropped to below 4 and 3.5. 3. That means your current account balance is 3 million. You know the limit is 5 million. Your limit is now your current account current balance is 3 million. What does it mean? Still, you can use 2 million differences. Right? 5 million is your limit. Your outstanding is 3 million. You started writing check to pay. Again, it goes up to 5 million fully utilized. Then you put the cash. Then your amount is coming down. Then you have a leeway to utilize. That kind of a facility is called revolving credit. So you can put example. You can write here example credit card permanent overdraft. Some importers are taking import loan facility. That again a revolving credit line. Import loan facility example, right? Credit card example credit card permanent OD limit overdraft limit. Then you have an import loan facility where you have a limit you taken and you take the loan. There are importers. What happened when the goods come? They don't have money. They have mortgage a property and have an import loan limit of 2 million. Okay, 2 million rupees. So when the import come, they will apply a loan. Then they take the loan. The loan is now utilized. When they sell the goods, they repay the loan. Now loan is available. When the other imports come, he take another loan. So this loan is, there is a limit. Always remember there is a limit for this loan. When you say revolving credit line, there should be permanent limit. Credit card, you have a limit. Permanent overdraft, you have a limit. Import loans, you have a limit. So you should have a limit for you to have a revolving credit within which you can utilize anytime. So the loan will be taken, loan will be repaid. Again, you can take other loan. Again, you can pay. It's keep on happening. That is what you call revolving. It's keep on happening, right? So depending on the cash flow, you can go for it, right? What is this loan to value ratio? Loan to value ratio mean you give loan based on the value of the asset. That is what called loan to value ratio. Loans are given based on the value of the assets. So it's generally in Sri Lanka, we have a loan to value ratio for motor vehicles. So what happened? The motor vehicles, when you purchase a motor vehicle, there is a loan to value ratio need to be applied according to central bank. Now you must understand when it comes to motor vehicle, it is something that motor vehicles, when it comes to Sri Lanka, I think we have overloaded with vehicles. So the government wanted banks to, when they are considering loan to motor vehicle, They are saying, okay, whatever. Now see, commercial vehicle is really required. Why? There are constructions taking place. There are huge projects taking place, different type of, you need to have a commercial vehicle. So truck and containers, all these are commercial vehicle. These vehicle is required, lorries and heavy vehicle, all these are required because these are used for development of or infrastructure project or day-to-day activities. So these vehicle need to be imported on a regular basis. Therefore, central bank says it's 90%. What do you mean by loan to value ratio 90% for commercial vehicle? In other words, if you take the value of the loan is 10 million, 90% bank can give a loan. So they are promoting loan to value ratio more mean bank can give a loan up to 90% of the value of the asset. That is called loan to value ratio. Loan can be given up to 90% of the value. That means bank can give maximum loan to the commercial vehicle. 90% can be given. So in other words, government promoting bank to give more loan for commercial vehicle. You can see government doesn't promote one item. What is that item? So look at that. Only 25% have been asked to give three-wheeler. Three-wheeler is a real, I would say, it's not a, there are a lot of things happening with these three-wheelers, right? So three-wheeler is one, the traffic congestion is because of them. And a lot of bad activities are also taking place through those three, this particular transport mode. So government doesn't want to improve this again. It's a real impediment to the transport segment, three wheelers, because they don't obey the regulation, right? And their literacy level is very low and they don't know how to follow the traffic regulation. As a result, a lot of accident taking place because of this segment. So government doesn't want to at all to support this segment. So they say if person want to buy a trishaw or three wheeler, only give 25%. So it's, let's say if the trishaw is 900,000, it's now about 1 million, right? 900,000, let's say 1 million, only 250,000, 25%, only 250,000 can be taken as a loan. Balance 750, the person who's buying the trishaw has to put. So therefore, he has to put more money because he can bank loan to value ratio for trishaw is only 25%. So what does it mean to you? If the trishaw value is 1 million, the loan can be given only for 25%. But on the commercial vehicle, you can see government is supporting because commercial vehicle is very expensive. So the person who want to buy a commercial vehicle definitely use for a commercial vehicle for commercial purpose. That is directly to the development of the country, indirectly supporting the development. Lorries taking goods, heavy vehicle, containers, all that are supporting for industry purpose, export, import, all that economy activity. So that segment need to be promoted. That is what they are given 90%. There again, they want the hybrid vehicle is something that is good to the environment. So you can see the car, SUV, vans, 50%. But when it comes, if you are importing hybrid car, SUV and vans on hybrid type, they are giving 70%. So in other words, if I'm going for a hybrid car, I can take 70% of the loan. Say I am going for a loan of vehicle of 5 million rupees. I can take 70% of 5 million. Only I need to put 30%. So I can buy a hybrid vehicle with the lesser money. But if I want to buy a petrol vehicle, I have to put 50%. See, 50%. So if I want to buy 5 million vehicle, I need to put 2.5 million. If I don't have 2.5 million, I can't go for 5 million because I am buying a petrol vehicle. Car, SUV, van is 50%. What does it mean 50%? The loan can be given for the 50% of the value of the vehicle. That is one loan to value ratio. Right? If the vehicle is 5 million, I can only, I have to put 2.5, bank can give 2.5. That is 50% for the normal petrol car. But if I'm buying hybrid vehicle, I need not to put 50%. I can put 30% is enough. So they are promoting people to buy hybrid vehicle. So if I am having a lesser money, I will go for hybrid vehicle because I can borrow 70%. If only bank can lend 50%. So bank, I can borrow more for hybrid vehicle. So they are promoting hybrid vehicle, electric vehicle to be used. And the electric vehicle is, you can see, they are further promoting 90% for electric vehicle. They are item number 5. Yeah, not hybrid. I'm sorry. Hybrid is 70. Electric is further, 90%. So they are promoting more electric vehicle. Because why electric is good? Because at one fine day, the crude oil, they are now forecasting, maybe other one decade or two decades, the crude oil will be at a very minimum level. So you need to use other energy to run the vehicle. So they forecast electrical vehicle is the best option. So they are now, most of the electrical vehicles are on the road. You can see some of the Nissan Leaf cars and all there. So in globally, there are other brand cars are available. So those electrical vehicles are promoting globally. Electrical vehicle is the market going to be now. Vehicle hybrid came. People were a little bit reluctant to buy hybrid vehicle. Now it's common. It's common now hybrid. When the technology improves, whatever the new innovation, initially everybody react, but resist. Why should we go for unknown technology? But once it is used, and then when they feel that economically those goods are viable, then they started using it. There's no nothing to lose. This in fact it's a benefit, because running cost is very cheaper for a hybrid vehicle, because it's hybrid. So it's work on a electric plus the crude oil battery. There's a battery, so power is combination of both. So the petrol is solely running on a crude oil petrol, so you will ever spend more for a petrol vehicle running cost. But when you use an hybrid vehicle, your cost of running the vehicle is very lesser, so they're promoting. So loan to value ratio is something where, what do you understand by this? Whenever their loans are given, that particular loan quantum is decided upon the value of the asset that you purchase. That is called loan to value ratio. In Sri Lanka, we have a loan to value ratio for vehicles, 90% for commercial plus electric vehicle. So these are promoted. Lesser is ratio, 25%, because they don't want to promote that segment anymore. So they are only asked bank to give only 25% of the value of the asset. You can give a loan. Don't give more money. Don't promote them. Then any other vehicle, 70%. Yes, any other vehicle, 70%. So you know this is the, maybe this ratio changes depending on the time, different times and different requirement comes. These are changing, right? So here you can write here if you want. Just say example. You can say loan to value, you can say, you can write the word, use LTV, LTV, loan to value ratio. So you can say LTV is used in Sri Lanka, especially for motor vehicle. LTV is used in Sri Lanka, especially for loans for motor vehicle, especially for loans granted for motor vehicle, especially for loans granted for motor vehicle. Loans granted for motor vehicles. LTV means loan to value ratio means, it is the percentage that can be granted as a loan. That is the percentage that can be granted as a loan to the value of the asset. To the value of the assets. To the value of the assets. To the value of the assets. Higher the ratio, allowing borrowers to borrow more, lesser the ratio, allow borrowers allow the borrowers to contribute more of their own money to purchase an asset. You can write an example, right? Say example, if a person say if a person want to buy a vehicle for 5 million rupees, example, if a person want to buy a vehicle, a car, you can say a vehicle, a car, a person want to buy a vehicle, a car for rupees 5 million, can take 2.5 million as a loan, 2.5 million as a loan, because the LTV ratio is 50% for the cars, because the LTV ratio is 50% for the cars, for the car, petrol car, right? If the sir, you can say, if the same person wanted to buy an electrical vehicle, if the same person want to buy an electrical vehicle, which is again rupees 5 million, which is again rupees 5 million, he could borrow he could borrow 4.5 million from the bank to purchase the vehicle, since the LTV ratio for electrical vehicle, is 90%. That means the vehicle is 5 million, you can borrow up to 90%. So at 4.5 million, you can borrow. Only you have to put 5 lakhs. So the amount is 4.5 million, right? So you can only put 5 lakhs, right? That understood? Right. Housing loan, yes. What is housing loan? Before that, anybody know what is the recent direction on housing loan? The central bank has brought a recent direction to the banks on housing loan. Housing loan, generally bank charge, bank to bank, different rates are applicable. Generally, I can remember 21%, then it brought down to 18, then somewhere around 15, 14, then it went up to, brought down to 11 to 12. So housing loan in Sri Lanka, if you take housing loan industry, the government want more people to own more houses because they want everybody to have their own houses. Irrespective of whatever the value, they should have their own houses. That is the aim of the government in the last budget. They say everybody to have their expansion of houses, everybody to own their own houses. That is the motive. That is the housing loans are being considered. Government has taken into account everybody to own, they have their own house, and simultaneously the develop the construction industry. So they want the construction industry also to be developed, while there are a lot of property developers are there and the government related projects also there. They want the construction industry to also to groom everybody to have their own houses. So it was very difficult for a privately working person to borrow a loan from a bank. It's very expensive. 18% is far expensive to borrow a loan. You need to pay 18%, right? If you are buying a loan, 18% is 1 million mean. You can calculate 18%. How much? 18%. Yeah, 180,000. You need to pay a loan for a per annum, right? It's large sum, right? So 18% is too much. Now, government has brought recent, very latest development. First 5 years, a fixed rate of 7%, you can borrow a loan. First 5 years, 7%. So you can make a note. The maximum interest charge for housing loan
is 7% for the first 5 years. 7% for the first 5 years. 7%. Very low. 7% for the first 5 years. The remaining years is a floating rate. The remaining years is a floating rate mean there is an average weighted prime lending rate, AWPLR. Average weighted prime lending rate, AWPLR. AWPLR stands for average weighted prime lending rate, AWPLR, plus 1%. The bank can charge. That's the best lending rate bank for customer. Best rate, very low rate they charge for the corporate customer. Say if you are giving a loan to normal person, 9% or 10%, they might give a special loan for 6%. That is their prime lending rate, best rate, lower lending rate. So central bank given direction, all the commercial bank are supposed to take a low housing loan. When they are granting housing loan, the maximum interest they should charge is for the first 5 years, fixed 7%, fixed. So if you are taking a loan, good time to take a loan for everybody, housing loan, because it's very low, interest rate is very low, which was 18% some time ago, or 14, now double 14. So it's only 7%. Anybody can afford to take a loan now. A small house, if you want to build, if you are working in a private company, a reasonably good rate, 7%, right? Very, very low rate. So 7% for first 5, not for the entire tenure, remember. No, don't work out. Now, if you say you are going for housing loan of 5 million for 10 years, don't work out for 7% for the entire tenure of 10 years. No, first 5 years only 7% fixed rate. The balance maturity period, balance repayment period after 5 years, AWPLR plus 1%. There again, that rate will be reviewed twice a year. Every 6 months, the rate will be reviewed, right? If the rate is low, the low rate will apply. So that is, in other words, it's a floating rate. So they given the flexibility of first 5 years fixed rate, remaining period, you have to pay. If the interest rate go up, you have to pay high interest rate. That is floating rate, right? There again, they are given a benefit, AWPLR, out of floating rate, the best rate, lowest rate, plus bank can add another 1%, right? So AWPLR plus 1% for the remaining year. So that is something. So everybody go for housing loan because everybody prefer to have their own house, right? That is for the housing loan. So you mortgage your property. You mortgage your housing property, whatever, to the bank. That is the security you give. You don't need to give any other security when you are going for housing loan. Or land. If you are buying an empty land, you give the land as a property to the bank and take a loan. Or if you have a land, you want to put a construction. If you have existing land, but you want to take a loan to put up a house, then the house that comes in the property will be mortgaged to the bank together with the land, because house is in the land. So you need to mortgage land plus house, that the entire house is to be mortgaged to the bank. So that is the security bank take in the form of a mortgage. So first time, you know, that primary mortgage. So this facility, remember, the government says 7%, that's a primary mortgage. If you are having already loan, you can't go for this loan, remember. If it has to be a new property, first time, primary mean. This is 7% is the primary. So you can't take a loan for the existing property. It has to be a first time. That property shouldn't have mortgage. It has to be a primary mortgage. I think we learn what is primary. First time when you do a mortgage. That means this facility is only for the people who are going to borrow year in after. As a new property, the 7% will apply. The people who have already taken housing loan, they are not eligible. It is not for the commercial purpose. Now the property developer who put a apartment, they can't borrow a loan for this. Those are for commercial purposes. Their purpose to put up house and selling. They can't borrow loan at the 7%. This is simply to the residents, individual to own their own house. The purpose is that. So the housing loan is only given to the residents, individual to have their own house. For that purpose, only central bank brought this rate of 7%, right? So you know the first 5 years, 7%. Remaining years, floating rate. That is again AWPLR plus 1%. AWPLR being average lending rate is the best rate bank can give it to the corporate client. They give it the very lowest. They calculate on their cost of funds and they don't add much of a profit. That best rate they can give is AWPLR. Best rate, central bank says, add the other 1% to cover your cost. That's all you can charge. So if I give you an example, let's say you taken a loan, the first 5 years you pay at the rate of 7%. After 5 years, if the market interest rate is 11%, let's assume the interest has gone up to 11%. That is a normal rate for 11%. But AWPLR of the bank is 9%. So you will have to pay AWPLR plus 1, not the 11%. You will pay 9 plus 1, which is 10%. Again, you get the benefit of, though the current value floating rate is 11%, you will pay 11 because you are given AWPLR plus 1. There again, you will pay. That again, that rate will be reviewed after 5 years. Every year, twice. Every 6 months, the rate will be reviewed. Sometimes bank may charge 6% when the AWPLR is 9%. All of a sudden, next 6 months, the rate is gone up to 14%. The bank can't charge the previous rate because the next 6 months, rate has gone up. The AWPLR has now gone up to 11%. You got to pay 12% AWPLR at the 1%. Because that rate is floating rate, market according, because nobody can forecast the interest rate for a longer period. So central bank can come and say the entire housing loan can be given at the rate of 7%, which will not work out practically. Why? This longer tenor, you can't fix the rate. Even 5 years fixing a 7% is a real benefit to the people who take the loan. Even next year, if the interest rate gone up, bank can't increase the rate. Why? The central bank fixed first five years 7%. So that's a real benefit. So whoever want to borrow the loan is the best time to borrow a loan. Because first 5 years, whether the rate is going up or down, you will need to pay 7%. That's a mandatory maximum level. If the rate is come down further, then you will not pay 7, you will pay 5 or whatever. But that chances of rate to come down is very unlikely. This is the maximum, right? So maximum rate is 7% for first 5 years. So that is mortgage. Your housing loans are, you know what, housing loan generally are fixed and floating. Look at the fourth point, bullet point, underline the word, housing loan will be have either fixed or floating interest rate. Yeah, you can't have a fixed rate, you can have a fixed and floating rate together. That is what this particular government direction also says, first 5 year fixed, therein after AWPLR, that means the floating, right? Yeah, in mortgage transaction, lender is known as a mortgagee, borrower is known as a mortgagor. The owner of the property is the borrower. So he has mortgage. He is the mortgager. The bank is become a bank has the legal right. So the bank become a mortgagee. So you should know the word, huh? In housing loan, the security is mortgage. The person who borrowed the loan called mortgager is the owner of the property, mortgagor. The person who the mortgage is owner of the property, the bank who lends the money, lender is known as a mortgagee. So remember the word, lender is a mortgagee, the owner of the property, the borrower is a mortgagor, right? Leasing. Yeah. What is leasing? This is again agreement between two party, you call lessor and lessee. Lessor is the owner of the property again. Owner of the property means it's become a banker. Lessee is the person who take the property for a rent. So if I give you an example, what is lease? Generally, lease are given for vehicles again, and some of the machineries too, building. But generally, in Sri Lanka, majority of a leasing are given for vehicles, right? So what happened? Vehicles, the leasing. Let's assume that you are working in a private, I will give you an example. You are working in a private company. Okay. You are not working in a bank. You are working in a private company. So you have come to join certain level. You have your own aspiration in your life. You took come when I'm coming to certain level, I need to have my small own car. I need to have my own transport, right? So you are targeting to buy a small vehicle, starting from small vehicle. That's absolutely perfect. Everybody should go from a level where economically you can pay that. So you should not go and do things where you are unable to pay. Those are not viable things in business also. These are evident. Most of the people are fail in their business because they start extravaganda businesses. Put up a large showroom, put up a large restaurant, but no businesses. Then ultimately they have to shut down the businesses. So it's always better go through the prudent way, the right way, There you have plan out, you working in a company, after 5 years, you come up to certain level, you want to have your own car. Then how do you plan out this? Okay, your salary is now 50,000 rupees. You get your next promotion, your salary is now 60,000. You are waiting your salary to go up to 70,000 proof. So within 5 years, your salary is now gone up to 80,000, right? Let's example, right? 5 years you worked hard. After 5 years, you got your promotion. Now your salary is 80,000. Now you are thinking of going for a loan. Now what you do? You will go and check a small car. Let's say you go for a Maruti. Or Quid. There's a small car, good car. These are good car on petrol, right? A Maruti is one of the good car. So very economical car. Spare parts are very cheap. It's starting from a small car, yes. Then Maruti is a vehicle you intend to buy. You go and check the vehicle prices. Let's say brand new vehicle, 3 million they say. So you know when you're buying a 3 million vehicle, you know the loan to value ratio now. If it is a normal motor vehicle, you can't borrow more than 50% because you know 50% is the LTV ratio. So if the vehicle prices is 3 million, you know 1.5 only I can borrow from the bank. Balance 1.5 million I have to put. So what you do, you collect money, you have already saved this money. You have 1.3 or some other, you borrow others and you put 1.5. Now balance 1.5 you want to borrow. So what do? You go to the leasing company and say, I want to buy a vehicle. You got a quotation from the car selling company, 3 million brand new car, everything inclusive. Can I have a 50% loan for this? Loan to value ratio 50%. So they will say, okay, we can give you 1.5 million. Then what happened? Then you are putting 1.5. The leasing company going to give you 1.5. Put together, 3 million will be given to the seller. Car will be in your name. You will start using the car. But remember, when the leasing company give you 1.5 million, there is an agreement entered between you as a borrower and the leasing company as a lender, right? Now in this lease agreement, both party agree the lease will be for 6 years. A brand new car, they give about 6 to 7 years. Say 7 years. Used car, you can't give, they don't give 7 years. They give a lesser period for used car. Brand new car, you use it for a long period. So brand new car, they give 7 years maximum. So you are taking the 7 years, you are buying a brand new car, you go for a 7 year leasing repayment period. They will work out 7 years, put the interest, everything. They work out that 1.5 million they are given loan, 7 years divided by the repayment, everything. Comes monthly, let's say 20,000 you have to pay. So you got to pay every month 20,000 to the leasing company. So every month interest plus everything added 20. So you need every month you pay 20,000 to the leasing company as per the lease agreement. After 7 years, you paid everything, the property will be transferred back to you. Until such time, the property will be interest in the bank. So because bank, the leasing company doesn't have any hold because they give 1.5 million vehicle also with you, but they will have the right. So that is where they will get a pledge. So you know the pledge and hypothecation? Pledge is with the bank. Hypothecation, you will be used. So the vehicle loan is hypothecation. So you will be start using, but they have the ownership. They have the right of the... So if you look at the RM in your CR, when your certificate of registration, that is the vehicle ownership of the vehicle certificate. In that interested party, the leasing company name will be there. Because when you sell it, the interesting party is there. They are also interesting party. Because it's the vehicle is in their name. Though you start using, they are the interested party. So remember, if you don't pay, they have the right to sell the vehicle and recover the money. So that is where most of these private bus people, when they start with one bus, when they repay, they have a lot of buses on lease. That is the lease. Lease is one of the best way to acquire property because you can, if you are generating income, you can repay. So the best is to go for a lease facility, right? Vehicle, plant, machinery. Generally, there are two types of lease, financial lease and operating lease. You can write stroke and put capital lease. Financial lease, other word is capital lease. Huh? Financial lease also can be called as capital lease. So what is operating lease? And now banks are giving only finance lease. Huh? Remember, banks are giving finance lease. Or you may call it as capital lease. What is operating lease? Operating lease is different, right? Operating lease is bank is not get involved there. Operating lease is for your knowledge. Operate leasing is something like that. Let's assume there is a property developer who is putting up a
8-story apartment, housing complex, right? Now, when you're putting up a construction, the eight story, so you should know the how much the strong the foundation should be. The entire weight will be on the foundation. So you have to have put a strong foundation. Dig the soil. So you can't dig the soil to put a foundation. You need to have machinery. That machines are called piling machine. So those piling machines are very expensive. So the property developer will go for the company who owns this piling machine and entered up a operating lease agreement. So he will ask the operating lease company, I want to use your piling machine for 6 months or 1 year, depending on your requirement, right? So you entered a 1 year leasing agreement with that company and you will pay a lease rental for monthly, let's say 5 lakhs you're paying monthly. But you're using 1 year, the entire machine is used 1 year to put a huge foundation. Because that machine will take the soil out within few, very convenient. You can't dig the with a man, you can't use the manpower to do that. You need to have a machine powers. So those machine can dig all the soil where you have a foundation for maybe 100 feet or whatever, depending on the strength of the building. So you use it for next 6 months or 1 year. Or if you have a two property, you take the same property, use it for 1-6 months a year, and take the same piling machine to the other property, other side, use it for 6 months, and after 1 year, you give the return, give the asset back to the owner. So you don't own the asset. In financing lease, you own the asset. Operating lease is you are using the asset and giving back to the on a rent, on a rent basis, you are using. That called operating lease. That is good for a machinery. I value machinery. So in operating lease, you will give the machine back to that. So you can, if you want, just note down here, just say one is financial lease, put other column, just different between financial lease and operating lease. Huh? Just to write down, put a T sign, one side you can say finance lease, other side you can say operating lease. Finance lease, you can say, finance lease, you can say you know what the terminology we use. Who is lessor? The owner of the property. The lessor is the owner of the property, right? The lessee is the person who pay for rent and using it, right? Lessee. So the lessor. So the here the in a leasing, the bank become a lessor, right? Lessee. You can say in that notes you can cite one finance lease, other side you can say operating lease. Finance lease you can write in this type of lease banks grant. In this type of lease, bank grant facilities to acquired assets. Operating lease, you can say, bank do not extend direct facility. Bank do not extend direct facility for this lease. That is operating lease. Right? Then you can say the second finance lease, second bullet point, you can say The lessee need to look after the assets. That means the borrower who has taken a car. If you have taken a car, you need to use the car. You have to look after your assets. Lessee need to look after the assets. The operating lease, lessor need to look after the assets. So I am buying on a rent. The machinery service has to be done by the lessor. Operating lease, lessor has to look after the assets. Lessor has to look after the assets. Then third point for the for you to understand better, you can say under finance lease, the asset will be transferred to the asset will be transferred to the lessee. The assets will be transferred to the lessee after the lease agreement. The asset will be transferred to the lessee after the lease agreement is completed. The asset will be transferred to the lessee after the lease agreement is completed and duly paid. After lease agreement is completed and duly paid, and DULY, duly paid. And on the other side, you can say operating lease, you can say after the lease period, the asset will be returned back to the lessor. After the lease period, the asset will be returned back to the lessor. Okay, right. We are moving on to the packing credit, right? So what is this packing credit all about? There are two type of packing credit, right? Pre-shipment, post-shipment. Remember two things. First of all, you should, when it's for packing credits, for your first you should understand within Beckett, you say this facility is only for exporters. First thing you should understand, this facility is only for exporters. Packing credit means you should understand this is for exports only. There's no other person. Packing credit only will be granted for exporters. Exporters of goods. Exporters of goods, right? What is this facility now, right? You know what is exporter? If you take Sri Lanka, we have a lot of exporters, right? They do export tea, they do export garments, they do export other accessories, rubber related industry, all that. Lot of export companies are there in Sri Lanka. They do a lot of exports, right? And they need two type of facility. One is before the shipment, you call pre-shipment, pre-shipment packing credit. Pre-shipment packing credit, post-shipment packing credit. So you don't actually call it as post-shipment credit. Packing is not, but we use it, but it's really not packing, right? So we, anyway, you if I really explain to you, what do you mean by pre-shipment? You want the money for you to keep the order ready. That is pre-shipment. You have got order to supply 1,000 shirts to a company in USA. You are a garment exporter. Now you got an order. Who has given the order? The buyer in USA has given the export order. He would have opened LC in favor of you, or he would have confirmed order. He says he's going to give you an order to make 1,000 shirts. As he will give a specification, colors, all that. That then accordingly to that specification, you are willing to supply 1,000 shirts. Huge order. So you want about 10 million rupees cash to do this order. So you come to the bank with the confirmed order. And you ask the bank, I got an order from the USA buyer, well-known buyer. I want against this order to grant a facility. So I will repay when I export the goods. So that is called pre-shipment packing credit. Before shipment, pre-shipment means write it before shipment. Post-shipment is after shipment. Shipment is after you ship the goods. Shipment means the goods that you are shipping, called shipment. So pre-shipment, before you do the shipment, packing credit. After is called post. So we are going to look at pre-shipment credit facility. Very short-term loan. Yeah, it's a short-term finance because once the order is exported, packing credit, you need to repay. Very short-term loan. Yes. You know it only for exporters. You have clear before shipment. Yes. What is the purpose for eligible exports? To procure raw materials. Yeah, procure raw materials, suppliers, process, manufacture. See, if you are a garment manufacturer, what is for you to procure raw materials? What is your raw material? Fabric. Because we don't manufacture fabric. We have to import the fabric. So you come to the bank and asking bank, I have an order for 1,000 shirt to USA. Let's say the order is $25,000. I want to import 10,000 worth of fabric from Thailand or China. So you come to the bank and open the LC where the bank is giving a packing credit facility. You import
from Thailand the fabric. The fabric come, you pay duty, then you started using the fabric with other accessories you have, and you prepare the shirt. Everything is done because the bank is given 10 million rupees facility for you to import everything. Right now, he finishes the entire thing, whatever loan that he has taken, and he finishes, keep the consignment ready, order ready. Now you want to ship the goods. But remember, when I'm saying when he has a confirmed order for $25,000, generally bank give about 75% of the order. So if it, the order is 25,000, bank can give about 75% only, or 7,500, other 7,015, maybe bank will give about $20,000 only they can give. Sorry, 75% is out of 15, maybe say $15,000 to $17,000 bank can give. About 75%, roughly 75% maximum they can give. So if your order is 25,000, you can take a loan about 18,000 to 19,000 maximum, right? That is the loan you can quantum you can take. So you have taken only $10,000 to import, only $10,000 rupee equivalent you have taken a loan. Right? You import the row, then you want other expenses, then you'd have gone for the entire 75%. You take the money, you started, you $17,000 you are taken, you convert into rupee, you start import LCs, you pay import and other accessories you buy other locally, and you go, the order is now ready. You ship the goods. When you ship the goods, you collect the money. The money will come. $25,000 will come. Then the bank will take their 15,000 or whatever loan they are given, balance, they will give it to you. That is called pre-shipment packing credit. So in other words, what is packing credit? You grant the packing credit against what? Look at the third bullet point. Banks provide packing credit against letter of credit or confirm export order. Yes, the order can be confirm order, or the buyer can open a letter of credit. So you know what is letter of credit? I think we will in detail will study in a separate session. I will explain. But for the moment, letter of credits are generally used in international trade opened by the buyer, because the seller doesn't trust the buyer. When they deal first time, the seller always asks the buyer to open a letter of credit. So when it comes to letter of credit, it's better than the confirm order, because confirm order is directly given by the buyer. When it comes to LC, it is not directly given by him. It's bank given the undertaking. The buyer's bank given the undertaking. So the LCs are issued by the bank. So exporter's point of view, the seller is the exporter. Exporter's point of view, which is better, which is most secure? Is it a confirm order or letter of credit? Yes, obviously letter of credit. Why? Why letter of credit is most secure? Because it is given by a bank. It's an irrevocable undertaking. Bank has given an irrevocable that cannot be cancelled, right? So it is always better exporters to deal with unknown buyer. Always unknown buyer to open LC, because when the LCs are open, the exporter is comfortable because the assurance is given by the importer's bank. Exporter orders are the importer's, the person who imports is order only you call confirm order. The confirm export orders are given by the direct buyer, direct importer. He has given the order, so he can default. You are simply trusting him and ship the goods. So generally, when you are a exporter, when you are dealing with a new buyers, always you start the buyers to open a letter of credit. You don't generally deal with confirm order. Once you have the trust after dealing with some time, then you can switch on to confirm order. First time you will tell the buyer to open a letter of credit, you deal with him for some time, then you switch on to confirm order. So both are acceptable, right? So that is how we work. Then once you export the goods, when the money comes, the bank will recover the packing credit and transfer the packing credit will be recovered from the export proceeds received from the importer, and the balance will be given to you. That is called pre-shipment credit, right? What is post-shipment packing credit? Here, this facility comes sometime. What happened when you are exporting goods to the buyer? Nowadays, the buyer will say, look here, I can't pay you immediately. I want 3 months credit period. Who is asking 3 months credit period? The buyer. So the buyer says he opened the LC, but he wanted 3 months credit period because he can't immediately. He is selling garments. The garments are slow moving item because due to current pandemic, it takes 6 months to realize all the garment to be sold. So he doesn't have capital to buy immediately to repay you. So he asking a credit period. So there are Sri Lankan exporters. They export goods to the buyers, allowing a credit period of 3 months. They start with 3 months, 4 months, 5 months. Maximum they can go up to give a 6 months credit period, depending on the relationship with the counterparty. What do you mean by counterparty? If you are dealing with a party in other country, you call counterparty, right? So exporters in Sri Lanka, importers in USA, the exporter's counterparty is the USA buyer. That is, you call counterparty, right? So the counterparty is asking a credit period now. Say you don't give a credit period if the party is unknown to you. You definitely don't give. But if the party is sure, because you have been dealing with long time, you started with LC, you switch on to the export order without LC. Now you have been dealing with him for more than decades, 20 years. Now he's a good person. You have personally visited his country and see, he's a very established person. Now you are willing to give a credit period of 90 days. When you give a credit period of 90 days, you ship the goods, you export the goods. Now goods have gone, you have the documents have given back, but you get the money after 90 days, right? So what happened? You come to the bank and say, look here, I have done export order of $25,000, but this money will come take 3 months time. But until such time, I need money to prepare my next order. Can you buy these documents and give me $25,000? That facility is called post shipment. After shipment, you are selling the documents to the bank and taking a facility. Why you are selling documents? Because the buyer takes longer time to repay. Buyer takes longer time. There's a credit period given. So you can see, look at the second point. There is always a time gap between a shipment of goods and the collection of export proceeds. That is a credit period you are given. There is always gap between shipment. That means you ship the goods in January, you are getting the money in April after 3 months. Collection export proceed taking in 3 months time. This time gap 3 months is required to be complete. So this 3 months period, you want the money. So the moment you ship the goods, you ask him, bank, can you purchase this bill? That's what you call purchase of export documents. See the word purchase of export document. Or you may say discount export document. So you have a $25,000 bill. You will ask the bank, can you check the documents and can you pay me? So the bank will go through, if it is a LC, bank will definitely purchase your bill or discount your bill and give the money. If it is not a LC, it's just a confirm order. If you are still sure, the bank might take some security and purchase your export order. So bank will give you immediate credit to you. That kind of facility called post-shipment. So you know pre-shipment is packing credit. Post-shipment is discounting bill and purchase of export comes as post-shipment. So pre is before shipment, post is after shipment. Pre-shipment is given to for him to prepare the order. Post-shipment is to after shipment for him to prepare the next order, because the buyer takes longer time to settle the proceeds. Therefore, the gap is covered by a loan. That's called post-shipment credit facility. Understood? Right. Now we are moving on to pawning. What is pawning? Pawning.
Keeping the gold and.
Yes, yes.
Getting it's a, gold, a loan.
Gold, yes. You accept the gold and give a loan to the bank. It's called pawning. So the pawning is a good business. Why do I say is a pawning is a good business? Compared to other loan, pawning is every bank promoting pawning. You can see advertisement on the paper, TV, where the banners are put everywhere. Because this is anybody can, if you have a gold article, simply you can walking into the bank and take a loan. There is no credit assessment. There is no repayment capacity. Nothing here. We studied 5 C's. All that is applicable to all the loans, including vehicle, every loan. But pawning that 5 C's will not applicable. Because you have the asset with you. They are coming and simply giving you gold and asking you to advance the money. Until they settle the loan, you have the gold. Therefore, you need not to worry about the repayment capacity. You need not to worry about their credit assessment, correct capacity. Nothing here. Simply nothing here.
These are short term loan for 1 year. You will be giving 1 year for them to pay. That is called pawning. Actually, pawning interest rate again, central bank, due to the pandemic situation, it was 12% per annum. Now they brought down to 10% per annum. So you can just write down the current mandatory pawning interest rate is 10% per annum. So if you work out for monthly, it's lesser than 1%, about points. So there again, government, earlier bank used to charge 2%. Remember, I can remember bank used to charge 24%, 2% per month. Pawning interest are generally per month, right? But when you compare, because these people are taking loan for 6 months. So every month you have to pay 2% for pawning. Every month, bank charge a monthly rate for pawning. But then due to the current situation, every household people are going through a tough time. There are people who lost their jobs, with the people who do not have any income. They have to survive. In a situation like this, central bank has to intervene. And they have to ask the bank to reduce the rate. So what they have done, the restriction, no bank can grant a pawning loan more than 10% per annum. So it is very, very low rate now. So if you work out 10% divided by 12, not even 0.9 or 0.8, whereas 2% they have been paying earlier per month. So now with a very low interest rate, you can pawn your article. So that gives some breathing space. People who are on the poverty line, take their gold, giving it to the bank, take an advance. After they have to pay interest, there's no repayment, a bullet payment they will pay. Not like loan, right? What you got to understand here, you take example, one person, he has a 3 sovereign gold, all 24 karat. Because depending on the caratage, the bank's lending amount will vary. They say any 24 karat, we will give 60,000 rupees. Below 20 karat, we will give 55,000. 65, 55, two rates are there. 65,000 they give for the 24. 55 they give for lesser than 24, correct, right? Two different rates. Then, if you have a three sovereign article, you go to the bank, it's a 24 karat, good one. So bank can grant 65,000 into three, they can grant loan. But you can take the maximum amount, or if you want only 125,000, you can get a lesser amount, no problem. There's no hard and fast rule, you can take the maximum. Whatever the amount you want to take it from. Sometimes you might go and take a 1 sovereign and you only take 25,000 rupees. That is possible because you only want short term. You don't want to sell the gold. You only want some money giving the loan. There's no other means to take a loan. So you have only a gold sovereign. You go to the bank, ask the bank to keep the sovereign and give her 25,000 rupees. Actually, you can take up to 55 if it is below 24 karat, or it is 24, you can take up to 65, but your financial requirement, 50 min or 25, whatever, you can take it. That is how it works, right? So you give the security as a gold article, bank can give a maximum, there's an amount to be given, whatever your requirement can be fulfilled, you need to pay monthly interest to the bank, then it's fine. When you want to take the article back, you go to the bank with the full amount. You say you have taken 30,000 rupees with a 1 sovereign. Monthly, you are paying interest of, say, 500 rupees or 600 rupees. You are paying monthly. You have to pay monthly interest, right? Every monthly, you pay only the interest you have to pay. When you want the article, you take the entire 25,000, go to the bank and say, I have taken 25,000. I have 6 months, I use it. I want the article back. So you have paid already interest. If you don't pay, bank will charge the interest up to 6 months and charge that and take their 25,000 loan and give the gold article back to you. That is called gold business. So the pawning business is one of the lucrative, one of the more income generated business bank point of view, because bank have the security. The gold is with them and they charge interest also. All this time they were charging good interest. Now central bank intervened and central bank brought down the rate to no bank can charge more than 10%, right? The customer redeem, what do you mean by redeem? Redeem means you take the gold again. After paying the money, you take the gold again, called redeem. Redeem your gold article. When you pawn the article, you take the money. When you have the money, you want the article to be redeemed. Redeeming, you are taking the article back. You repay the loan and take your gold back. That word is called redeem. Redeem your article, right? The broker, the value of the gold is fixed by the market rate. It's a market rate. Now you can see the 65,000 for a gold sovereign is
because the gold price has gone up to 90,000, 85 to 90. I think once it went up to more than 100,000 also. Remember, the gold price is something that's very fluctuating, right? So bank also to be very, very careful when they are granting loan more amounts. They have to be very careful, because what happens in 2004-05, if I'm not mistaken, I think 2014, about 6 to 7 years ago, once the gold price started coming down very deeply, a decline, very deep decline, then what happened? Most of the bank granted loan. Market values, when the market value is 90,000, they granted the loan up to that time in 2014. It never went to 90,000. It went about to 60 to 70,000 range in 2014. Gold rate went up first time 60 to 70,000. Most of the bank granting loan up to 55 to 58,000. When the gold price is 70,000, they are granted the loan up to 58 to 60. Some bank went up to 60, right? So you must understand, when the gold price is very high in the market, granting loan at a higher price is very risky. If the gold price is coming down within 3 months back to 50,000, what is the position of the bank? Look at that way. If the gold price can come down very quickly, within a short span of time, it can come up to 50 to 60,000 from 90 to 100,000. Then you have granted a loan more than you are holding. That is where the pawning happened in 2014. Bigger banks, I think two, three banks lost in billions of money. They lost because the gold price coming down. So you have to be very careful when you are dealing in gold price. Again, same thing, same trend is going in now. The gold price is very up. Anytime it can come down. So bank has to be very careful. I think bank now play a safe game, because you know why? They never gone up to, when the price is going up to 100,000. They never went to 80,000-90,000, because very high risk. They're keeping at the range of 65,000. I would say 65 also very risk. We never know, it may come up to 70,000 to 80,000. Then the margin is very narrow. So you have to keep a higher margin, because the market fluctuation is very high. All of a sudden, gold price can come down to 50-60 range. So then you are into problem, right? So that is where the advantage and disadvantage I have written. So if you get a question, what are the advantages of pawning? Very simple, because you take the article, within the few hours, you take the money and go. Very simple way to borrow. If you are taking a normal housing loan or whatever, you have to more than a 1 month, 2 months, you have to spend. Article, document need to be checked, title need to be checked, lengthy process. But yeah, gold pawning article, very within few hours, you can take the money, provided you have a valid gold owned by you. Right, it's simple process. No credit evaluation. 5 C's, nothing will apply. Facilities secured by the articles. Yeah, you have the gold article, easy for the bank to give the loan. Disadvantages: higher interest rate is charged, but of course 10% is now, you can't say higher, because the government has reduced the rate. Earlier it was higher. Some bank charge 15, some bank charge 12, but now central bank has brought down the rate to 10% to everybody. It's a mandatory. Everybody has to follow. Fluctuation of the gold price is very risky. Yes, that is a dangerous. If the prices has come down, bank has to incur a severe losses. Then the other thing is fake article and stolen article. Because some people, they bring the fake article. It's not a gold. They bring a fake article. Then what happened? A bank has some of the bank has lent for the fake article. Then they auctioned the gold. They found those are fake. Now what happened? There are high density, high technological advanced machineries are used by banks to gauge the real gold. If it is a fake gold, the machine will indicate. So you have equipment now to weigh the gold, to gauge the quality of the gold. You have a machinery. So bank use the latest machinery, right? And the other thing is stolen article is the other problem. Because sometime what happened, when a guy comes with the bank also to be careful, because there are people who steal the gold from somebody and they come as their own gold and pawn the article and they vanish. Say a thief has stolen a gold from a house and or snatched the gold while a lady is going on board and come to the bank next day and pretending that it's his own gold, and he pawned the article, right? He has taken 100,000 and gone. It's a three sovereign bank has given 100,000. He will come and ask. So sometimes the pawning people who are working in the bank also are given certain training how to catch these people. Yeah. So bank, if you are a smart pawning officer, you can catch those people asking few questions. From where did you buy this gold? For why you are stealing? There are suspicious. There are some smart pawning officers. They decline. They don't decline. But these people go to the private pawning place and pawn those articles somehow or other. Because the private pawning people don't have much training, so they might take that as a gold. They might take the owned by that guy and they will lend it. But they are into problem. If this guy get caught to the police, what will happen? Police will ask, where did you keep? He will come all the way to the bank and say, I pawned the article here. So there's a problem to the bank also. So you have to be very careful. Those are the disadvantages. Stolen article, you should not take, but it's very difficult, practically very difficult. Yes, easy to say, but practically very difficult. But you know the background of the people can be evaluated, right? So when he comes, you can ask you a question, because there's no credit assessment here about him. But again, practically, there are people who come and give the stolen article and take the money and go. So that is something with experience, you can catch these people. But there are cases still you don't catch, because those people are very smart enough to cheat the bankers, right? They come with a very, or give it to somebody and take the gold. That also could happen. The steal, the guy who taken the gold and giving it to some other person, say, can you pawn? And necessarily that person getting caught, in the event if the police catch him, he will tell, I have given it to this person. That person also unnecessary taking into, why you knowing that this guy has stolen an article, why did you go and help him? So you have to be very careful with this, right? So those are some of the risk in pawning businesses, right? Okay. We are moving into fee-based services. What is fee-based? This is, now you know, there are two way banks generate the income. One is interest, one is fee. The interest income is, you know, is very, very narrowing. So you can see, if the central bank brought down mandatory requirement 10%, you can't charge more than in the pawning business. The bank interest income is now shrinking, getting reduced. Housing loan, they have been asked to give only 7%. Interest FD rate is 3% or 4% bank pays. But again, loan rate also reduced to very 8-9% moratorium. Now, if you really work out, bank that have been enjoying very good spread. Spread mean the interest that they pay and the interest that they charge between these two rates, bank has a good spread. That means the difference between these two rates are very high when you are lending it at higher rate. So you have more income generation from giving a loan. Now the government involved, when all the rates are come down, banks can't earn any more interest anymore. Very, very low income bank can generate now. So take example, all this time bank have been granting pawning 24% and later 18%, later 15%. Now they have been asked to take only 10% per annum. So all the interest that they have been taking from pawning also now gone. So their interest income is shrinking. Now they have to focus on any other way of generating income. That is where the fee base coming. Here, only service you give and charge a fee. There is no physical movement of funds available here. It's only a service related. So you give the service to two segments, retail and corporate. What do you understand by corporate? Bigger company, bigger government organization, bigger. Take example, if I say corporate, John Keels, Dialog, Haley's, SLT, all these are bigger people, bigger companies. Retail fee, retail mean an individual person, a small businessman, small shop owner, you and me are retail. So a bank earn fee from retail customer, bank earn commission from corporate customer. Here bank earn more from corporate customer, because corporate customers are using very, very high technical services.
They want to raise funds. They want to borrow. They want to issue shares. They want to issue debentures. They want to borrow for import exports. So a variety of services bank offer for corporate client. But of course, retail client, common services. Everybody want a credit card. Everybody want a lease facility. Everybody want a personal loan for buy a computer or whatever. Everybody want a vehicle loan. Everybody want a housing loan. Are similar. But the corporate is not like that. Corporate is totally different. So the retail business is common to everybody. When as an individual, what are the things you want? You want a credit card, right? You want a vehicle. You want a house. You want a personal computer. You want some MBA, whatever you're studying, education loan. That's all you want. All are common in nature. But when it comes to corporate, different corporate want different loans. Say a bigger hotel, John Keels want to put up a hotel in Male, in Maldives, they want a project loan, totally different. Or Dialog want to put up other tower to increase their television network, totally different segment. Or some hotel putting up other restaurant or other hotel in jungle, different project. A garment factory putting up a huge garment factory in free trade zone, different project. So each corporate has a different requirement. Their requirements are unique, different from each other. But retail customers' requirements are similar. So both bank can earn a lot of commission. So let me see, what are the corporate services? Cash management. What is cash management? You can also call it as PCM. Payment and cash management. PCM, you can call it. You write PCM. Payment, cash management. Payment and cash management. PCM or cash management services, letter of credit, bank guarantee, forex, merchant banking, underwriting, custodial. What is cash management? I have given notes, I have given for you to understand. So you at least if you know this is enough, but I have given a notes for you to better understand it. What is cash management? You can also call PCM. Actually, what is this service is? Now bank is focusing to generate their fee income, right? There is no way they can lend it more than and charge interest anymore. So they are now looking at other revenue stream. What is the other revenue stream where they can earn more commission, more fee income? From where? What are the avenues there? One of them is cash management services. Now bank has a good payment system. You know what are the payment system? Yes. You have a payment system, all the banks are connected. Now bank can offer a variety of financial services to their corporate client. Take example, now Dialog has employees. So they have 4,000 employees. There is a separate administration department looking after that 4,000. There is a separate department for purchasing. There is a separate department for selling. So there is a 4,000 staff. As an administration department working about 150 people, they are the people making salaries, making overtime, making the EPF, ETF, all this contribution. There are employees, right? And there are the department purchasing goods and making payment and collecting funds from all the other service. Whoever taken Dialog as a corporate package, they're collecting rental money, everything. Huge operation. So what happened here, banks going and telling Dialog, look here, If you have your cash account, you have a current account, give the current account to us. Whatever you want, we will do it for you. In simply what they are saying, you need not to have an administration department. We can make salary to all your employees. Give the list of your people and the account number. Give the list of your supplier to whom you are to collect the money. Give the people whom you are making the payment. We will make all the payment. We will make your utility bill, your electricity bill, everything we can make. Only thing is we want instruction. See how they are making the life simple of Dialog. All their costs can be cut down. All the Dialog cash box is transferred to the bank. What do you mean by cash box? Their current account. Their current account is given to the bank and bank has been asked to do all the salary payment, all the collection of money, all the suppliers payment, all the utility bills, banks will do the entire payment and they manage efficiently.
See, what I'll give you an example. Say Dialogue has a current account. They collect all the rent. You know, we are paying subscription. We are paying everybody as a Dialogue bill. We pay. So likewise, they collect all the money and the entire money go and deposit in the bank account, current account. And the Dialogue has a current account of 5 billion in the current account. The account, the manager administration people will use, they know the 5 million is lying, but they gradually making the payment. But this 5 million is lying in the current account for last 10 days. But for which Dialogue hasn't earned any single cent income. But if that five, if this same current account is given to the bank to manage, what the bank will do? Bank is going to manage the Dialogue current account. Bank knows this money is unnecessary lying in the current account. Now bank is managing the Dialogue current account. This is the cash management service. Bank is managing the cash of the Dialogue. Now what will bank do? Bank will immediately transfer to the interest bearing account and put that 5 million and give the benefit to the Dialogue. And see, and the payment of salaries are simply they will ask Dialogue to give the list of staffs who are working 4,000 people and their EPF number and their bank account number. Each one will have a bank account, right? If they don't, they will open a bank account at whatever the bank. Let's say Bank of Ceylon offering these services. Bank of Ceylon will ask all the people to open account at Bank of Ceylon. Because Bank of Ceylon says, we will give a credit card to you. We will give a debit card to you. So every staff, despite they have an account, they are opening their salary account with Bank of Ceylon. Now all the 4,000 people open an account with Bank of Ceylon. I'm giving an example, right? All the 4,000 people immediately given the debit card, credit card free. Because it's, there is a huge fee income going to be generated by the Bank of Ceylon by taking these 4,000 employees. Now what happened? Dialogue given the cash management, entire management to the Bank of Ceylon. Bank of Ceylon going to look after the entire payment of Dialogue. What will happen? Dialogue, the administration department work will be minimized. Very efficiently, their cash management will be looked after. And all the payments are made on the spot, immediately, without any hassle. The staff, extra staff looking after the Dialogue administration work is no more required. Because the bank is offering the entire services. In a way, if you really take it in a way, there could be some, by bank offering this kind of services, there are people who are working in Dialogue might lose their jobs. Why? Because the administration people, now actually the bank intention is not to have the people's job to be lost. And no, their intention is to give efficient services so that the Dialogue people can use their resources to marketing. The administration staff could be used for marketing purposes because they don't have work. Because bank is doing all the administration work. So those people can be employed for their internal marketing, other skill they can utilize. Not that they are going to lose the job. They will can be utilized. So in a way, bank is assisting the corporate client by offering a cash management service. In simply, bank is doing the entire cash management of the corporate company. This is offered to the corporate and the SME people also, small and medium people. So that is called cash management. Bank looking after the entire cash management, making payment, collecting payment, making staff salary. Example, if you want, you can write all that. Right? Salary payment of the staff of the company, collection of payment, making payment, transfer the current account to the interest bearing account, all that efficiently managed. Right. Letter of credit. You know what is letter of credit? It is opened by importer when he wants to get down something from the exporter through the bank. That is called letter of credit. Right. This is again, the bank is charging a fee. Say, if you want to open a, if you want to get down a vehicle, you are not buying from a, you are buying, not buying from a local agent. You are directly importing from Japan. So you have to open a LC. Currently, remember, currently in Sri Lanka, import of vehicle is currently banned, totally prohibited. Unless otherwise there are certain vehicle, mostly all the cars, vans, Jeep, SUV, nothing can be imported since last March. Yes, almost now 9-10 months gone, no vehicle. You can see all the showroom and the used vehicles are displayed in the showroom because there's nobody is permitted to bring down any cars, any vans, SUVs, nothing. Because the government
has taken a policy because we are running short of foreign reserves. The vehicle is not required at this moment. So all the luxury vehicles are stopped bringing down to the country. That is the reason you can see when you go to the showroom, all the used vehicles are displayed because hardly you have any brand new vehicle anymore because last 10 months, we have not imported a single vehicle. So when you're importing a vehicle, you need to open a letter of credit because the supplier, for the supplier's point of view, you are an unknown person. So he will ask you to open a letter of credit. You will open your bank through the bank to open LC. When you're opening LC, you have to pay a commission to the bank. So these are the fee-based income. So if it's a large corporate client import exports, so they are opening multi number of LCs with the bank. That is the other services. Bank guarantees. Yeah, bank guarantees also used heavily. Bank guarantee means bank issue a guarantee, then bank become a guarantor. Here the guarantor, bank become a guarantor. So when I'll give you an example. Guarantor means when is the bank guarantee used? Suppose say, now take example, this some other importer of food item will take Nestle. Take example of Nestle. Nestle importing lot of food item, dairy items. They import butter, then they import cheese, they import milk powder, varieties of item. Milk powder, they import varieties of product, right? Now, they have island-wide sole distributors, right? What Nestle does is when the Nestle importing items, they will supply to the sole agents. They don't go and sell it to the retail shop. They will have an agent. So the agent will have a transport fleet of vehicle. He has the resources. He has a lot of vehicle and he has a storage facility. Everything is there. So they select those people and they supply the goods to them. Say Nestle, when they import a dairy product, everybody, every distributor given a 10 million worth of goods at any time. So the distributor, when the goods are coming, when the Nestle goods imported, all the imported goods will be distributed to the main distributors. Each distributor will have a 10 million. Say in Colombo, there are 10 people. Each one looking after each area. Colombo 1, Colombo 2, Colombo 4, 5, 1%, 6, 7, 1%. Likewise, there are 10 distributors in Colombo. So they give the entire 10 million worth of 100 million come. Each one have a 10 million goods. Distributed among 10 people. Now remember, the Nestle giving all these 10 million to everyone without any single cent. These people will have to sell it and repay to the Nestle. They go and in their area, they have a retail shop. They go and supply them. And when they sell it, they collect the money and then pay to the Nestle. So this process might take about 3 to 4 months. Until such time, Nestle is out of funds. And there's a risk if the distributor doesn't pay, there's a risk. Therefore, Nestle will ask every time when they give 10 million goods to the local distributor, they will ask everyone to give a bank guarantee. Now, each distributor has to give a 10 million worth of bank guarantee favoring Nestle through their bank. So, in other words, you should have a facility with your bank to issue a 10 million guarantee. Each distributor has to issue a 10 million guarantee. So, in simply, it's a document given by a bank. No condition, right? So, all 10 distributors, say number 10, all number 10 distributors are given 10 guarantees, each 10 million each. Now, Nestle has 10 guarantees from number 1 to number 10, or A to A, B, C, D, all that. Now, if the A doesn't pay for after 3 or 4 months, A try to default, they can claim it through the bank guarantee. They can use the bank guarantee and claim the money from A. The bank has to pay. The guarantor is the bank. So when the guarantee is issued by a bank on behalf of A in favoring a Nestle, when the Nestle demand the guarantee, bank has to immediately pay. So the guy knows if he default, there could be bank guarantee he has given, there could be claim. So he never default. He somehow or other make sure that he will repay. So see, with the bank guarantee, facilitate the transaction between two people. So that is where the bank guarantee coming in. So when bank guarantee, they charge a commission. They are again fee-based, right? Then Forex. What is Forex? Import, export. When you do Forex, mean remittances, inward remittances, outward remittances. This is mainly on import-export customers. They buy foreign exchange. They convert rupee into dollars or dollar into rupees. currency, other currency. That is called forex, means foreign exchange. Forex stands for foreign exchange. FOR stands for foreign. EX stands for exchange. Foreign exchange means you are converting rupee into dollar or vice versa, dollar into rupee, forex. This is import export service. When they offer this service, they charge commission. Say your brother is working in Middle East, your father is working in Middle East. They send the money, remittances, inward remittances. They earn and send the money. Bank charge a small fee and credit the money to you. Or if you want to make a payment, bank will charge a fee and send a payment. If you want to receive a payment, likewise, when you're making payment for import payment, receiving payment for export, bank charge commission. That called forex services, right? Then bank charge much. I told you there are corporate company when they want to. What is IPO? What is FPO? IPO stands for initial public offering. When a public quoted company started, when they want to collect their capital, they have been given permission to issue shares. Not the private company, public quoted company. There are two companies, private company, public quoted. So whenever you read the name within bracket PVT comes, those are private company. Pereira and Sons private company. Okay. And if you say Dialogue PLC, banks are PLC. PLC is a public quoted company. PLC means public quoted company. Public liability company. So public liability company can issue shares and collect the capital. So when a newly formed company want to issue a public order company want to issue capital and collect their issue a shares and collect their capital, you call IPO, initial public offering. This is follow-on, FOWWON, follow-on public offering. That means once you collect the money, thereafter, if you want to issue it again, you call FPO, follow-on public offering. Initial public offering, follow-on public offering. There are two ways of collect your capital to the public quoted company, right? That is how they collect the capital. So that is called merchant banking. So underwriting is, there is underwriting services here. What is underwriting services? It generally comes when you issue a shares as a general, as a first time. If the people don't buy the shares, the underwriting service provider will say, I will buy the shares. Say, for example, if I give you an example, say ABC company is a public quoted company. They have been permitted by the registrar of company to issue 1 million rupees, 1 million shares and collect the capital, each share 10 rupees, right? A newly formed company. They put a paper advertisement and they say, we are going to put up some garment factory. They are going to issue shares, 10 million shares, 10 million shares, each 1 rupee, they are going to collect their 100 million. 10 million into 10 rupees, they want to collect 100 million capital from general public. That is their target. So they issue shares. But underwriting services, they sign a contract with a commercial bank who provide the underwriting service. They will say, if we are unable to sell these shares, will you be able to buy? The underwriting service provider will say, okay. If the initial IPO, if you are unable to sell the 1 million shares, we will buy 10 rupees at a fee. But at a fee, they will charge a fee to buy shares. So they will look at the company's strength and they will offer that service. That is called underwriting services. In the event of an initial public offering, if the company is unable to sell their shares, the underwriting service provider will buy their shares, remaining shares. That services also give them a commission, right? That is called underwriting services. So you can see the last paragraph of the underwriting arrangement may be created a number of situations, including issue of security in the public offering. Yes, public offering, IPO, initial public offering, underwriting services is important. Custodial. What is this custodial? Say if you are a high net worth individual, you have a lot of money, but you don't like to keep the money in FD, but you want more return. The bank is offering only 5%. So you will go to the custodial service provider. Now banks are giving custodial. Some of the bigger banks are giving these custodial services, right? You will go to the bank and say, I have 100 million rupees. You have a rich person, right? So say a rich person approach a bank. He says, I'm giving you 100 million. Can you give a good return to me? About 6-7%. Because he knows jolly well, he can keep the money with FD and get a 5%. But he comes to the bank and talking to the custodial people, asking the custodial people to give more return. The custodial says, oh, we will try to give a more return. We will give 7%. Right. Now, what is happening? When they give 7%, they will charge a fee. For the service they offer, they charge a fee.
the 100 million guy doesn't mind paying a fee, but he wants the 7% return. So this particular custodial service provider take the customers 100 million. They invest in variety of investment. They invest part of in treasury bill, get a 6%. They buy shares and issue, or they issue debentures and collect money. They invest in various instrument, and at the end of the day, they are in a manage to give a more than FD interest, more than fixed deposit interest. They are managed to do 6 to 7% interest. By giving that interest, they are also earning a bigger fee, right? And also they are having a large fee. That called custodial service. This is offered for the I individual net worth, right? Retail service, that is you and me. What are the services bank offer? Right, we payment, fund transfer, remittances, credit card, debit card. Now see, every bank coming and putting in the advertisement. Why can't you take our debit card? Why can't you take our credit card? Why can't you online banking? Why can't you do your mobile banking? What are these? All are delivery services for which a commission is charged. When you buy a debit card, when you take a credit card, there's a fee. Each transaction when you do, there's a fee deducted. When you do a fund transfer, 50 rupees deducted to the other banks. When you do a fund transfer from your bank of Ceylon to People's Bank, there's a 50 rupees. But remember, it's very convenient. What is that? What is the technology you call that? All the banks are connected. What is the, how do you call it? CEFT, Common Electronic Fund Transfer Switch, CEFTS, SEFT, Common Electronic Fund Transfer Switch, SEFT. With the SEFT only, banks are offering all services, right? Online services, remittances, credit card, e-banking, mobile banking. You can do anything with your online account, right? So every transaction, there is a fee. So bank earning the fee by offering efficient delivery channels, bank charging each fee. These are the way to bank to increase their fee-based income. Right. We are into the last few slides. Yes. Non-fund-based credit facility. We want to finish this today, right? Non-fund-based credit facility. I think I explained to you what is letter of credit, bank guarantees, right? Now, remember, these two facilities are not a fund-based, not a fee-based. You call non-fund-based credit facility. You don't put it as a fee. You don't put it as a fund. But it's non-fund-based credit facility. It's in between. Now, you know there are two segments you study. One is fund-based, one is fee-based. What is fund-based? Movement of funds. Loans, fund-based liability, fund-based asset. What is loan? Fund-based asset. What is deposit account? Fund-based liability. What is fee? Now all this is fee, what we learn now. Yeah, all this is our fee. Yeah, corporate client, you offer services. Retail client, you offer services. So you have fund-based and fee-based. But here you call it non-fund-based credit card. It is in between. It doesn't fall under fee. It doesn't fall under fund. It's non-fund. But these facilities are special facility. You have example of bank guarantee, letter of credit. You call these facilities as contingent liability. Let me explain to you. Now take that same example. I told you Nestle giving 10 million to 10 distributors, right? Now bank has given a bank guarantee 10 million to each distributor, 10 million, right? Now remember that 10 million bank guarantee, it's just a instrument only, right? Just a bank guarantee only. As far as this distributor continue to pay to the Nestle, this is going to be just a piece of paper. The bank guarantee is just going to be a piece of paper. There is no outflow of funds. Though the bank issue a guarantee, there is no immediate outflow of funds. Remember. When it comes to outflow of funds, in the event of a default, now see, chances of this is become a facility very remote, right? Now see, if I am the distributor, I have given a guarantee from my banker favoring this 10 million. Now my facility is blocked. Now I don't have 10 million cash.
I have some security I given to the bank and I ask the bank to issue a guarantee. That's all. Now bank doesn't, there's no outflow of money. Bank just give a piece of document only. This document will be treated as a loan or facility in the event Nestle claim. For Nestle to claim, I have to default. The chances of my default is very remote. So now you can see with that knowledge, read the definition of contingent liability. You can see contingent liabilities are liabilities that may incurred by an entity depending on the outcome of uncertain future event. There's no sure. It can be very, very remote, uncertain future event. That means the bank guarantee, when it comes into force, only the money will go out of the bank. Say, example, I have given a 10 million guarantee to Nestle. As far as I am a distributor, I sell the goods, collect the money and paying Nestle, absolutely the bank guarantee remain a piece of paper. When it comes to liability, when it comes into force, in the event, I'm not paying to Nestle. Then Nestle says, look here, I have the bank guarantee. I'm going to claim. You better pay. Immediately, I will pay. I know if I don't pay, Nestle can claim it from my bank. Until the claim is really happening, it's not a facility. Therefore, you call it as contingent liability. So what is the definition? Contingent liability is not a real movement of funds. It is a event of an uncertain future. So therefore, though you issue a bank guarantee, you can't keep it as assets or liability. Now, when you grant a loan, you put it under assets because loans are assets. When you take a deposit, you put it under liability because you have to pay the depositor. But remember, when you are issuing a bank guarantee, you can't put it into the asset, you can't put it into the liability. Therefore, you call it off balance sheet item. How do you call that? In the previous slide, you can see here, see the last line. These liabilities are called contingent off balance sheet item. That means this doesn't reflect in the balance sheet. The bank guarantee do not reflect in the balance sheet. Why? It is not a real liability. It will be real liability when Nestle claim only, it will become a liability. Until such time, it is not a liability. Therefore, bank guarantee is a contingent liability. What do you understand by contingent liability? It is the future uncertain event. So you can read this. It is a future uncertain event. Therefore, it doesn't reflect assets or liability. It is an off balance sheet item. But you need to, a footnote need to be put in the balance sheet. Right? Say, for example, I'll give you an example. You are buying a TV. There's a warranty given. Right? The warranty bond is given in the event of default only they will do. So if there's no use, if you are using the TV up to 1 year or laptop or what, 1 year without any problem, that's over. The warranty is over. Though the warranty is given, the warranty doesn't come into force as far as there's no repairs. Same way, when you're issuing a guarantee, as far as the distributor repay the Nestle, no claim. It's a piece of paper, right? Similar. Right. So, example of contingent liability, letter of credit, bank guarantee, acceptance of bill of exchange that we will study later. Right. So, that ends the session. Now, I have homework for you and a small announcement too. Right. Now, I will be not taking next 3 sessions. There will be other lecturer because it's an online class. He covers on weekdays because now weekend. Are now online, he will be covering certain accounts and certain foreign currency account. He will be covering 3 sessions probably, right? So from next Sunday onwards, I will be not coming. The other lecturer will come in. I think his name is Mr. Nimal Lakshman. He will be coming and lecturing you. But I have a homework for you. There is a paper I have given you. Let me take that. Please do this exercise. I think everybody has this exercise, right? Go through this exercise quickly, right? Quickly go through this exercise and do it. So you have multiple questions, about 10. Yeah, I think you can, and you have a few small question about other 10. Altogether, I have given 20 question. No, I think about 20 question is there. 10, 11, 12, 13. Yes, 20 question is there. So you have to answer all that is what you have studied. All what you have studied, right? So go through this. Keep ready with these answers. When I'm coming, rejoining you after three sessions, after three lectures, we will go through this and starting a new session, right? So take this opportunity to once again wish you each and everyone. So meet you after 3 weeks time, right? So probably not 10th, this is today 3rd. I will be not there 10th, I will be not there on the 17th, not there on the 24th. Probably I'll be there on the first week of February, right? So until such time, but remember to do it today itself, then you don't forget it, right? Make your brief answers, right? These are all past paper questions. Try to do it so that you are covered this area. So when we move on to that, we will look at the different areas, right? So then see you in the February, probably most February, I will see you. So give your comments or whatever. So once again, best of luck for the rest of the year, LU education. Okay, see you then.